Hello and good evening from Delhi, where 50 participants from 8 countries have come together to talk about the future of Afghanistan. This initiative has been made by the Delhi Policy Group and the Afghan Institute of Strategic Studies. This is the third meeting of such happening, two in India, one in Herat. Today we're at the end of the conference. We have 5 members of the conference today in our discussion to talk about the role of the region for Afghanistan, especially in 2 years' time when the NATO is leaving and there is expected to be a vacuum. The question facing the conference and us in this discussion is how the region is filling that vacuum. Participants in this conversation are Dr. Radha Kumar, the director of Delhi Policy Group, Hossein Sheikh al-Islam, an advisor to the Iranian Majlis Parliament, and Abdullah Bozkurt, a Turkish journalist, Dr. Davud Muradian, the director of Afghan Institute of Strategic Studies, and Colonel Oleg Kolakov, a professor at the Moscow Defense University. Thank you, everyone, for being on the show. Dr. Kumar, talk about this initiative, talk about this conference. Why Afghanistan becomes important to the region now?
There are 2 or 3 different reasons why Afghanistan is critical. But let me begin by saying, why did we, the Delhi Policy Group, decide to do regional conferences? First of all, as you're well aware, Afghanistan has been a top policy priority for India for many years now, certainly since 2001. And our activities have grown over the years rather than diminished. Why do we see you as so important? Partly, of course, it's our heritage. We have had long ties with Afghanistan for thousands of years. And there's a very deep affection in India. The Afghan people and the country have a special place in the Indian imagination. So that's the bigger, softer reason. Then, of course, comes the question of our security. As you know, under the brief period of Taliban rule, India was attacked several times from Afghanistan. And also there was training for some of the radical groups who are attacking India happening in Afghanistan, in Khost, for example. And so we were very anxious that that should not happen again, that Afghanistan should be a sovereign, free country that has good neighborly relations with all of its neighbors and does not become subject to any form of proxy wars. That is our main security strategic reason for highlighting and profiling Afghanistan. And I would say the third big reason for us is that Afghanistan can also be a gateway to Central Asia for us. And Central Asia, too, thousands of years ago, was part of a common economic and cultural space at a time when Central Asia, South Asia, and the Gulf countries and countries like Iran were at their most prosperous. These are the years of the Silk Route and the tributaries of the Silk Route. So if we can regain and reopen those ties once again, we hope that more prosperity can come for the people of our region, our citizens first, but also Afghan citizens, Pakistani citizens, Bangladeshi citizens, Sri Lankan citizens. We hope all of us could benefit.
But some of these initiatives, particularly led by India, is provoking concerns of some other countries in the region, primarily Pakistan. How do you respond to that?
Well, indeed, when we first started, when the Delhi Policy Group first started its activities in and on Afghanistan, we began with a trilateral, India, Pakistan, Afghanistan. For this reason, that we wanted to clear up any suspicions or misperceptions that Pakistanis might have about what India was doing in Afghanistan. So we wanted to tackle those, we wanted to clarify, we wanted to remove any doubts, And we wanted to make it very clear to our friends in Pakistan that India has no interest in fighting any proxy war against Pakistan. We are not against Pakistan. We have no interest in being against. We believe we must be friends. And indeed, if you look at our strategic partnership, the Afghan-India strategic partnership, right up in, I think, the first or second paragraph, our two countries say that this partnership will never be used against any other country. And that is for Pakistan.
Mr. Sheikh al-Islam, one of the big questions today in the room was how the region would react to any possible collapse in Afghanistan after 2014. Iran obviously has been one of the critics of the US presence in Afghanistan, calling it an occupation. The US is bound to leave in 2 years' time. How countries, including Iran and others in the region, would react to that vacuum?
I wish it never, Afghanistan never collapse, and it will not collapse. I'm sure of that. Afghans have proved that they can do their life in the most harsh situation, and we have this experience at the time of Soviet one war there.
But do you see any change in the role of Iran in 2 years' time?
It depends on the Afghanis, what the Afghanis want. Once we agreed that, for example, we built Dogarun-Herat road, we did it. We are building right now Dogarun-Herat, or in fact, Mashhad-Herat railway. We are developing Chabahar. We are doing on the customs on Milak and custom on Dogarun, whatever we can. At the number of the trucks that are going from Iran to Afghanistan and coming back with Iranian goods or other transit goods, it's amazing. I rent them myself. So anything we can do for Afghanistan, we do it. It depends on what Afghanis want. Of course, there are close to 4 million Afghanis in Iran. There have been before too. And dealing with this issue, which is a very hard social issues, mixing many things together, is a challenge. In Afghanistan, when you move toward Iran, you see more secure and secure. When you get to Herat, it's almost secure.
I think there's also an argument that the Afghan-Iranian border is not safe all the way along. Probably you can see signs of insecurity in districts of Farah, which is also on the border. But I mean, how Iran can see its role?
For sure, I don't want to blame the Afghanis for the insecurity which happens in the border. This insecurity mainly is from the drug trafficking. And drug trafficking, it is right that drug is produced inside Afghanistan, but I do not see the Afghanis responsible for this. There are big cartels from the United States all the way to the border that are interfering and have a benefit in this trafficking. Of course, it's a big problem for Iran. It is a big problem for Afghanistan. It will be a big problem for the future, because this is the this drug which are, I believe that more than anybody, any place else, the drug produced there. But don't forget, this is not the Afghanis people. If the poverty was not there, I believe that this would be diminished. I don't say that all of people are good, but many people do this just for living. That the income for many of Afghanis is very minimal. Mainly those cartels, especially who are on top, and they are mainly the businessmen or politicians, are getting the gain from this. The second is that the terrorism which exists there, this terrorism again is coming from the poverty. So the development does play a great role in diminishing the drug trafficking, drug production, and terrorism.
Given your concerns about the situation, do you suggest that the transition is a bit premature?
No. I believe that the sooner the foreigner goes out, the better. The less foreigners stay in the Afghanistan, is the better.
And you expect no vacuum to be left once NATO is withdrawn?
For me, it's not a vacuum. The problem, the main source of the problem, is the presence of the foreigners. The foreigners, they have their own agenda.
And what are those agendas?
This agenda started in 2001. And they were trying to blame Muslims and some of these terrorist activities which happened in the United States or was happening on the Afghanis people or other in this region, which is not right. Right now, they are using all kind of mechanism to destroy this terrorism. But the terrorism didn't destroy. The terrorism today is much more than 2001.
One of the concerns, obviously, Moscow is sharing with Tehran is the presence of Americans after 2014. And one side, Russia is criticizing or somehow labeling the withdrawal as a bit premature, calling it that the job is not done, the Afghan forces are not ready. But in the same time, since the American plan to stay post-2014 primarily on a counter-terrorism capacity, that's also posing some sort of concerns to Moscow. Why do you think that in one side Russia wants the foreigners to stay and in the other side opposing a U.S. role in 2 years' time?
So thank you for your question. And so you're right. So there is the point is that there is no unity in Russia for the issue. Not only among politicians, among experts. So our expert community is divided into several camps. So mainly in two camps. So some of them think that the presence of the foreign troops is positive, and the other camp just doesn't think so. They think that it is counterproductive. So the foreign presence in Afghanistan is counterproductive for not only for Afghanistan, for the region. My personal view, I am an expert of the country. I am an expert of the region. So we have to know for sure if the United States of America and NATO declare officially they leave the country, we have to know for sure if they completely leave the country. If they say that we leave the country, but we will deploy several bases, so for me, as a military man, so that doesn't mean that they leave the country. For me, so that means that they will stay in the country. And as an expert of the country, I should know for sure if they leave the country, that there will be one strategy developed by Russia. If they stay in the country, so that will be another strategy towards the region, towards Afghanistan. And so we have to be sober and we have to be informed about that. I myself believe that the foreign presence, as an expert of the country, is counterproductive. I belong to the camp which thinks that the foreign presence is counterproductive. But as I have said, there is no unity among Russian experts and among Russian politicians and among even Russian intellectuals.
Does it mean that Russia has a wait-and-watch sort of policy towards Afghanistan, waiting to see what happens in 2014 and then coming up with a strategy?
No, I do believe that Russia will develop its policy earlier, and will the policy will be. That will be one policy. So, of course, there cannot be the policy of one expert community, the policy of another expert community. That will be one policy. And I do believe that Russia will formulate its interests, and on the basis of those interests in the region, including Afghanistan too. So Afghanistan will be a part of that strategy, because for us right now, so Afghanistan is one very important part of the region, Central Asia. And so we're very much interested in the development in that region. We are very much interested in the security in that region. And we are ready to positively cooperate with anyone who is positive in that respect. That is why we joined, so we participated in the conference organized by the Delhi Policy Group. So they artistically performed that conference. And so we are ready to continue that cooperation with them. So we are ready to cooperate efficiently with our Iranian colleagues. So we have very good experience in this respect. And of course, we are ready to cooperate with Pakistani experts in this regard. Let alone that we are ready to cooperate positively, and we have very good experience in this regard. We respect each other. So with our Afghan friends and brothers in this regard, but we in future have to be sober in this regard. So we have to know, everything for sure.
You talked about Pakistan. Moscow is trying to strengthen its relationship with Islamabad. And we've seen a lot of interactivity over the past years or so. Do you think Russia is in a position to convince Pakistan to be more productive in Afghanistan's affairs?
I do not believe that Pakistan needs to be convinced in anything. So Pakistan is a very independent state, just to formulate their own interests, for one. And so they can just defend their position. And I do not believe that it will be productive to convince Pakistan doing this. But the point is that the situation in the region and Russian policy is based on it, so will be formulated on what is going on. And for instance, dealing with Pakistan, so we just, for, as you have said, we have been active so for the last 2 years, more or less. But so we, I should say, so those interests are bilateral. I can't say that someone can influence each other position. So we are partners, and we are going just to develop our activity with Pakistan, so on partnership.
Dr. Mouradian, there has been a lot of initiatives by regional countries to contribute to Afghanistan's stability and prosperity. But there's only one big question from an Afghan point of view, that is there a unified approach in the region towards Afghanistan or not?
Unfortunately, there is no such unified approach, because in our neighborhood, we have a number of countries who have conflicting interests. In some respect, there is a convergence of interests. A stable, a peaceful region needs a stable and peaceful Afghanistan. And I can see there is a consensus in the region about the interdependence between Afghanistan's stability and prosperity with the region's prosperity and stability. But one problem that we have, there are some countries in our neighborhood who have some other interests, which is in clash with Afghanistan independence, with clash with Afghanistan prosperity. So there is a convergence of interests in some respect, and there is divergence of interests here. What we have been doing in Afghanistan, either by the government or the civil society, the media, is first to highlight and strengthen those areas that there is at convergence of interests. For example, the question of the drug. Drug is a major issue for us in Afghanistan, a major issue for our brothers and sisters in Iran, and also a major issue for Russia. So there is the question of the drug is a good example that can bring us together here. The question of the connectivity. I mean, Iran needs to have access to Central Asia. Central Asia needs to have access to the Persian Gulf. Central Asia needs to have access to the subcontinent here. Therefore, and Afghanistan needs both Central Asia and South Asia. So there is another area of cooperation that exists is the trade and connectivity. The terrorism, for example, that. Russia is facing huge terrorists, India, Afghanistan, Turkey, Iran, even Pakistan here. So terrorism can also bring us together here. But when, but now it depends on the region's maturity. Can we separate our differences? Can we isolate our differences and focusing on those areas that united us together here?
How do you bring Pakistan and India together? Is there, terrorism has proven to fail in bringing or allying Pakistan and India's interests in Afghanistan, and we've always talked about some sort of a proxy war even in Afghanistan, the conflicting interests you talked about. So how we can basically ensure that Afghanistan is a sovereign country or going to be a sovereign country in 2 years' time, and treating India and Pakistan both in a sovereign manner. Is the Afghan government capable enough to convince these two important players in the region that there has to be some sort of a bilateral approach?
I think we should not make the mistake of equating Pakistan and India. India's interest lies in independent and prosperous Afghanistan. There is no differences between Kabul and Delhi on any issue here, is that. As Dr. Kumar says that historically and empirically, Delhi wants a peaceful and a stable Afghanistan.
But do you agree that this is a counter-India measure from Pakistan?
I think it has become a leverage for Pakistan. Use terrorism to blackmail India, to blackmail Afghanistan, even to blackmail Iran, to blackmail United States. So blackmailing the international community has become a part of Pakistani calculation. And also, it has been very lucrative for Pakistan. Pakistan has made billions of US dollars out of the sponsoring terrorism. So terrorism not only is a policy of Pakistan, but also is the most lucrative export of Pakistan here. And therefore, I think what we have to do in our neighborhoods and international community to disincentivize Pakistan, that Pakistan's must not be rewarded for promoting and sponsoring terrorism.
But that capability, Dr. Mouradian, is not in with the region. I mean, today's conference has proven that it is hard to convince Pakistan. So what kind of conclusion you can make out of such an environment?
I think the terrorism that is driven from Pakistan is not only an regional problem. It is also an international problem. The 7/7 terrorist attack in London was originated in Pakistan. Every single terrorist attack in Europe and recently in the United States have some link with Pakistan. Therefore, Pakistan has become a sanctuary and centerpiece of exporting terrorists here. Therefore, we have to recognize Pakistan as international crisis, and we have to do two things here. First is to empower and support those forces inside Pakistan who share our interests, who share our concerns. But also we have to confront those people in Pakistan establishment who still rely on terrorism as a means of policy, as a means of leverage, and also as a means of making money here. So we have, I think the solution is that when we convince forcefully Pakistani establishment to stop differentiating terrorism, there is no good or there is no bad terrorism. Terrorists, by definition, or bad, and they need to confront terrorism.
It's pity that we talk about Pakistan, but we don't have a Pakistani representative here. But we have Turkey, basically, who's been promoting some sort of an Afghan-Pakistani cooperation. Last month, there was the seventh of Turkish-Afghan-Pakistani trilateral summit in Ankara. I remember in the first conference, in, I think 5 years ago, during Musharraf time, the initiative was to reduce the tension in the borders. But this year, after seven times of such meetings, we had border shelling and we had cross-border terrorists coming and going, and the border tension was at its peak. So now the question is that how countries like Turkey, basically one of the key players in the region, can contribute to the fact that Pakistan should be part of the solution, not part of the problem?
I think Turkey has already contributed a lot. There was tension there for a long time. In the last summit, there was an assassination attempt to the Afghani National Intelligence Director. It failed, thank God. And the guy is recovering. But when you see the, you know, the president of both countries, you know, both Karzai and Zardari, you know, sitting together in front of the Turkish president, talking to each other directly, without any intermediary, without any mediation, I think by itself is also quite an accomplishment. We have seen that similar, you know, thing happen last year after the, you know, assassination of the Rabbani. One thing I want to mention here, I think we are too much focusing on the, you know, pessimistic picture in Afghanistan. I told this in the last meetings in Herat. I was amazed, for example, and gave me a lot of hope when I saw the report that the Afghani students, they collected over 70 international awards in different fields, in science, in math, you know, in different educational sectors, in a competition that was participated by more than 100 countries. So that shows us if with the right tools and instruments given to the Afghani kids, I think they can make a huge difference. They can compete with, you know, with the people who got, you know, best of the education in America or in Turkey or in other places. So it all comes down to the, to the, you know, infrastructure in the health, in the education, developing the human capital capacity of the institutions in Afghan society. I think that's where Turkey is really making a difference. I was very encouraged to hear, for example, in this panel discussion that the kids, you know, going to the schools, enrolled in the schools in Afghan, it has climbed up to almost 9 million people. It was 1 million in 2001. So that's a huge accomplishment by itself. One third of it is girls. I think we need to keep focus on this positive success stories as well. I think there's a lot of going on here in trade, in, you know, in economic cooperation, in different fields, and we need to dwell on this. And Turkey is...
I mean, I think the Afghan people do recognize the achievements in the past 10 years, but one of the concerns is obviously the fragility of these gains, that how we can make sure that these aren't reversed. So that's why 2014... and the withdrawal of NATO and the US, the combat mission in particular, is a concern. So the follow-up question is that, is the region or the wider region capable enough to make sure these gains are not only reversed, but consolidated and extended and developed?
To answer your question, I think I'm also very optimistic on that one. There is an international commitment, no doubt about that. We have seen in different meetings, in different venues, from Tokyo to Bonn to Istanbul. There is international and regional commitment as well, even in this.
But it's primarily Western. It's I really don't think the region.
Well, I think Turkey is also Western and Asian at the same time, and the Turkish commitment was very strong and still is very strong. And we have seen, you know, heard the remarks from the Turkish president and the Turkish prime minister, you know, on many occasions. We're going to be in Afghanistan as long as Afghani people wants us to be there. We don't have a deadline. We are not going to pull our, you know, troops helping out Afghani people or reconstruction team or aid groups, even the NGOs, when the 2014 comes. We're going to be there forever. I mean, the main reason is we have, you know, heartfelt compassion towards the Afghani people coming from the deep historical and cultural ties. We never forget, for example, how Afghani people helped Turkey when we are fighting our war of independence. I mean, in the minds of the every Turks. So we are not going to abandon, you know, Afghanistan when the 2014 comes. We're going to keep, you know, providing aids, trying to develop capacity, institutional capacity, and human capacity in Afghanistan, and trying to make a difference. And I think the main answer to your question is the local ownership is very important. I think we already seen that. I mean, we were in Herat before. I walk in, you know, in the downtown area. I mean, I talk to the merchants. I talk to the different people. I think the local ownership by the Afghani people, because at the end of the day, they are the ones who's going to decide their fate. We can help to a certain extent. So I'm not much worried about the rollback on the accomplishment already made and the fragility of the issue. And we need to keep working on this.
To come back to the question of the fragility of the progress, is the region capable enough to deal with it, to make sure it's strengthened?
Okay, let me answer this in two different ways. One of the things that we heard today, which was very, very impressive, is the speed with which Afghanistan's neighbors are working on connectivity. Now, Sheikh Saab over here talked about Iran. Already the Charbahar Mashhad Road and Mashhad Herat Road is quite well developed. They're working very fast to develop it further. They're going to also build a railway. And as you know, India is working on developing Chabahar so that we have a route now that will connect Central Asia through to India and then beyond to the other countries of South Asia. The Turkmens told me that they are building a railway very quickly from Turkmenistan to Afghanistan. The Uzbeks already have a railway. The Turks have a railway line going Turkey, Iran, Pakistan. And we have high hopes that at some point the government of Pakistan will agree to let that railway connect to India as well. So at the connectivity level, I'm really heartened. I see that the region is making huge efforts to try to be in position to ensure connectivity and therefore trade and prosperity by 2014. They are looking at that deadline. They are thinking about what do we do, how quickly can we do it by the time a transition happens. And you know, connectivity will also indirectly help in terms of peace and stabilization, in that the more you have freedom of movement, the more you have a pressure on, let us say, the bad or the people who want to wreck the progress that Afghanistan has made, the more they will be isolated and the more pressure there will be on them not to act in the way that they do act. We've seen that happen in our own country. Certain parts of our country that were under insurgency, we've seen that there has been a shift at the level of the population. There is no more support. There are no sanctuaries. There are no safe havens for the people who wanted to try to have an insurgency. And that, at the end of the day, is what has made the insurgency come to an end, more than our military action. But I will say that actually, in cases of insurgency, you do need strong security. You need a security that will act as a deterrent and that will make sure that an insurgency cannot go beyond a point, which we did manage quite successfully. And certainly, I think that most countries in the region also feel strongly supportive of the further development and strengthening of the Afghan national security forces. So I think you're going to see a lot more help on that front as well.
But I mean, these
training, capacity building.
But I mean, these assistance are to an extent seen by Pakistan as a counter-Pakistan measure by India. I attended a conference of South Asia youth in Bangladesh last month, and I had a conversation with Pakistani civil society activists and some of the MPs, and they were saying that India, being the fourth largest donor to Afghanistan, spending $2 billion for the past 10 years, and offering a scholarship for Afghan students, and this being a hub, you know, for Afghans coming for medical assistance. So the Pakistan's question is that why India, when Pakistan can offer that, some of those in, particularly, and India being a country in need for these assistance domestically, why offering such an assistance to Afghanistan? How do you respond to this Pakistani concern?
Well, I think it's illegitimate and irrational, to be quite frank. I see no reason for Pakistan to worry about Indian aid. And there is absolutely no strategic or security reason for them to worry. Indeed, I have said it in public time and time again that we recognize that Pakistan is one of the top most important actors for Afghanistan. And they have their own reasons.
And that means there is no solution without Pakistan.
Of course there can be no solution without Pakistan. And let me also say, I believe that Pakistan has a legitimate concern about instability in Afghanistan. After all, across the border, you share common ethnic populations. Historically, there has been some issue which no doubt, as things settle down, as Afghanistan stabilizes, I'm sure that the governments of Afghanistan and Pakistan will find a way to resolve some of those historical issues. But right now, the emphasis has to be on ensuring, number one, that Afghanistan can keep some control over its own borders, ensuring that the progress that Abdullah has referred to, the education, the economic revival, the social activities and benefits, your wonderful new developments in sport that Afghanistan is making, all these great achievements.
Lost to India two times in cricket.
We are very confident. Actually, I was talking to my Pakistani colleagues yesterday. They both agreed that in 10 years' time, Afghanistan will be able to beat both of us. So we're already conspiring to see how can we gang up to prevent you from doing this.
I think sports can bring Pakistan and India together to make sure they have a unified approach towards Afghanistan. I have a question for you, Mr. Shaykhul Islam. You talked about, you said the sooner Americans leave, the better it is for Afghanistan. And the sooner they leave, we're going to lose $4 billion aid to our Afghan forces and a remarkable assistance.
But they can leave, the aid can stay. The forces can leave, the aid can stay.
But their argument is that there has to be a mechanism
if
of
they
training
are bounding,
and assistance in long term. So the question is, can countries like Iran and the region basically be an alternative to the U.S.?
No. We do not, according to our constitution, we cannot intervene in other nations, and this is number 154 in our constitution, that we are not allowed to interfere in the other internal affairs of other nations. Sometime, government of Afghanistan, a legitimate government, ask us some help. Surely we provide, if we can. In general, we believe that Afghanistan should be ruled and should be governed and should be secured by the Afghani people. When other nations or other countries come, they have their own agenda. They are looking for their own benefits. Sometimes these benefits coincide with the Afghani people, sometimes it doesn't. And that is when you have the problem. For example, a spying American over Iran is something beneficial for the American. but it's not beneficial for the Iranian or Afghani people, because we are no doubt that we are closer to each other than the American and Afghani. We are the same ethnic group, we are the same languages.
But more than 90%, one of the recent surveys I read, was suggesting that the Afghans favor a U.S. presence in their country. So the question is why Iran is opposing it.
I don't know about the survey. I don't know about the areas that you have taken the survey. Right now, there are 4 million Afghanis in Iran. We have the same language, we have the same culture, we have the same religion. And what we see from the American forces, that they are not respecting this mutual culture, this mutual religion, the thing which happened in Afghanistan, which bothered the whole Islamic world, the curse that they made to the Afghani's bodies, dead bodies, the curse that they made to their book, divine book, the way they act. Don't come and tell me that the American act as a proper. If they wanted to act as proper, they wouldn't look for capitulation. They do not want, they do not even believe that to be tried in Afghanistan, where they do a mistake.
But we do get reports of discrimination even from the country where, in which we share culture and tradition and language. For instance, one of the recent events or incidents in Iran was that there were places in Isfahan, for instance, that the Afghans weren't allowed, and there were, you know, parks that the Afghans weren't allowed, and there were logos there. I mean, these things also suggest that they really don't get a good welcome in Iran, too.
No, I mean, if they wouldn't, they wouldn't come, first of all. And I'm not saying that everything that we do in Iran is right, but there is a big difference. American doing a mistake in Afghanistan and not getting, not even going to the court, and a mistake that Afghani does in Iran and doesn't get a good trial. They are completely two different things. You see that the Afghanis are our guests. They have come because they wanted to come. And we respect them. There are 4 million, and I believe that some things happen. I mean, all those Afghanis who come to Iran are not divine angels, like all the Iranians. Many times, this is the Iranian that have done the wrong to the Afghanis. But this is something that they agreed, the Afghanis people and Iranian people, to live together in Isfahan or in Qom and in Tehran. And things happen, I agree with you. And I'm not saying that everything is fair. But this is completely different with a force that comes to the house of an Afghani, breaks the door, because he's afraid that he'd be killed even by somebody who trained himself.
I want to raise a point here, basically. We talk about, you know, a unity of approach from the region. So I would like to ask a question from all the guests here, that who, apart from yourself, who is thinking that Afghanistan is occupied by the Americans?
No, I don't think it's occupied by the Americans, and you have an agreement in place already, and even beyond 2014. And just responding to Shaykhul Islam's remarks, I think I find it very cynical when I see the Iranians, you know, trying to provide an explanation from the American perspective. They are trying to solve their problems on the bilateral level with the Americans using the Afghani ground, very much the same like the Pakistanis looking at the, you know, the Afghanistan from the Indian perspective, or some of the Indian probably see from the Pakistani perspective. So I said some of them.
You are using nonsense.
You need to respect the Afghani decision, but you are not respecting when you're saying, and you need to get rid of the Americans or other troops. If the legitimate Afghani government, elected by the people, decides to make an agreement with a foreign country, whether India, whether Turkey or American, I mean, they have the right to do so. Why do you object that? When you say, you know, why do you send drones? Then you send drones to the Hezbollah.
I think we can't get that recording properly. So I would suggest you make the point, and then if you have any argument, we can do it later.
For example, you raise the issue of drones. No country has a right to violate another airspace, but you're also sending drones to the Hezbollah in Lebanon, and they are sending to the Israel airspace. I mean, is that a cynical?
No.
It is. It is a cynical approach. I mean, we need to stop looking at the Afghanistan from the other countries' perspective or from the problems that we have in other countries. We have to look at through Afghani people's eyes. Then I think we're gonna really, you know, make a difference on the ground. Otherwise, we're gonna keep discussing these issues forever, and we are not gonna be ending anywhere. I think we need to be very constructive here. We need to be very positive and not try to export our bilateral problems to the Afghani or try to send the bill to the Afghani people for the problems we are having with other countries. We should stop doing that.
Probably you know that when I was in Herat, I suggested that we are ready to sit with the American only for question of Afghanistan and nothing else, as we did sit with the American on the question of Iraq, when the American wanted to leave Iraq, but were not sure that Iranian will replace them. I said that if the American want to leave Afghanistan, I am ready and Iran is ready to sit with the American only on the question of Afghanistan and American leaving Afghanistan to be sure that we are not going to hurt or replace them. So there is no reason, and we don't need to solve our problem with America in other places. You see that even sometimes we don't want to solve our problem with America. America in our eyes, in our mind, are not the America is that in the other body's mind and eyes. America for us is the one who intervened in our internal affair, and we took over the embassy.
In the Afghan context, what's really important?
In the Afghan context.
Yeah, what's really important is that Afghanistan cannot be without any of. So it's not a matter of choice for Afghanistan between Iran and the United States. And how Iran and the United States can work together on Afghanistan.
I said we are ready to sit and discuss the problem which made American think by leaving Afghanistan will be taken over by Iran. We are not going to bother them if they want to leave Afghanistan. We are not going to replace them. We are not going to harm them, anything like that. If they want to be assured like we assured them in Iraq, we are ready for that. We do not want to play with the Afghanist people and their well-being on our question and our problem that we have with America. We have a lot of problem with America. We have the question of Palestine. We have the question of our atomic energy, peaceful energy program. And the question that he mentioned, we do not confess as Israel to be a state. We believe it was occupied with Palestinian land. So if we give a drone to Hezbollah, it's completely different from a drone that comes from the American bases on our soil from Afghanistan. I know, and I'm not going to blame you, because we sent to the highest official in Afghanistan and we objected, and he said that we cannot do anything. You know that we cannot do anything. We do not accept this, but we can understand that answer. This is completely from a different story that we sent a drone to see that if Israel is going to attack Gaza, how they will do it. That is the reason we sent the drone. And you saw that the attack was started, and it is right, the Iranian missile help the Palestinian to push their condition over the Israelis.
It's a brief question, basically, that how do you see a post-2014 collaboration between the region and the West on Afghanistan, especially that Moscow has a lot of anxiety and concerns, that how these anxieties can be removed and there can be a unified approach and there has to be some sort of an understanding and a balance?
So, thank you for your question. Of course, Moscow is concerned about 2014 after a new stage of development is expected. So, but nevertheless, as I have mentioned, we have to be properly informed if the U.S. troops leave the country. That will be one strategy. If they are going to stay with their bases, that will be another strategy developed by Russia. But of course we will, but the point is that, you see, just in, to continue that discussion with, of my colleagues, my Iranian colleagues and my Turkish colleagues, you see, Napoleon used to say, said that bayonet is a universal thing. You can do almost everything using it, with one small exception. You cannot sit on it. You see, the presence of the foreign troops is counterproductive in Afghanistan. And so, at the same time, so this Russia supported American presence from the very beginning just to establish peace in Afghanistan. But since it is proved to be counterproductive, so we must summarize the results of that process. And that the Russian approach will be based on the experience and what is going on. So what is really is going on. And of course we will be concentrated on cooperation with neighbor countries, with India, with Iran, with Pakistan, and of course with Afghanistan. So it's on the issue. Thank you.
Professor Mouradian, to sum up this discussion and conversation, one of the President Karzai, I think last month, he said that the Afghan foreign policy would change dramatically in 2014 and Afghanistan would look towards the region more than it does now. How do you see that shift? And in the same time, how do you see the response of the region towards that shift of the strategy? Another follow-up question that here we talked about the role of Pakistan, and I remember you said that we can survive without Pakistan. So if you can briefly touch on that, we'd appreciate it.
We can also survive without Iran's cooperation. And also, that is also the case, yes. In response to your question, I think we have to acknowledge that the Afghan conflict has three dimensions. One is the internal and domestic reason of the conflict, which is our responsibility as Afghan and the responsibility of the Afghan governments to tackle the question of legitimacy of the governments, the authority, the capacity of the Afghan governments. This is our responsibility. The second dimension of the Afghan conflict is the regional dimension, which is the responsibility of the regions. The third dimension of the Afghan conflict is the international one, that we had the Soviet occupations, which contribute to what we are suffering right now in Afghanistan, to Al-Qaeda, United States, a war here. Therefore, the Afghan conflict cannot be solved alone with Afghans. We need our responsibility, and we also need the responsible policy of the region, because they had a role in contributing to the Afghan conflict, and also the international community. Therefore, we should not seek to replace the region with the West, or to replace the West with the region. I think for us, the
but
challenge
there has to be a balance.
It's not a question of the balancing. It's a question of the complementarity, that there are some issues that the region can contribute better. And there are some issues that the Western can contribute better. So the challenge for us, both in Afghanistan and the regions, and in the international community, is have to find a complementary approach, complementary solution to the problems here. And that is, I think, important for the foreseeable future for Afghanistan, because in this 21st century, you cannot localize problem. All problems now interconnected here. The problem of the drug, the problem of the terrorism, the problem of underdevelopment, they are all interconnected, and we all have responsibility to tackle those problems. On the question of our neighborhood, I think that applies to all our neighbors. I think that they need to realize that there is a new Afghanistan. A new Afghanistan who wants to live in peace as equal partners with neighbors. We do not accept anymore to be the lesser brother, the smaller brother. We want equal brothers. We want to be equal brother with Iran, equal brother with Pakistan. This is our choice in Afghanistan, the new Afghanistan, that we want to be a brotherly relationship with all neighbors. But if countries do not want to wish and treat Afghanistan as equal brothers, it is their choice. It is their choice, and we can live without that here. There are some countries, life will be much difficult. I'm not saying that it will be a perfect world. Our first choice in Afghanistan is to live in a brotherly, good neighborly relationship. This will be our first choice. But if the countries in the region cannot treat us as equal brothers, this is tough life, and we can survive in a difficult neighborhoods. And there are some cases, as I gave the example of North Korea-South Korea relationship. South Korea was and is a prosperous country, despite having North Korea as neighbors. East and West Germany, West Germany was prospering and is during the Cold War, despite having East Germany here. India-China relationship, despite having a difficult relationship between China and India at some point, I think both countries survive and prosper here. So therefore, I think the region does not hold a monopoly on our survivability, on our prosperity. But our first choice is to live in a peaceful and good neighbor relationship. But if that is not possible, we have to go to the next option, which is to live as independent country, having a strong relationship with our Western partners.
Panel members.
Equal brotherly relations in Afghanistan.
Yes, sir.
Panel members, from Russia to Iran, from Turkey to India. Of course, Dr. Ashraf and I from Afghanistan. It was such a diverse conversation. We enjoyed it. Thanks for your time and appreciate being part of this conversation.